I've been listening to the new band, and I do want to get to the politics, but I have to get to that. Your new band is awesome. I just wanted to say that. There's nothing to fucking say about it.
It's not that new a band anymore. I think it's actually technically been together longer than Dead Kennedys has, the real Dead Kennedys anyway. It's been a long time since albums, so this one's finally about to drop when the mastering finally works out on two last songs. Yeah. In the meantime, we're sneaking these videos out. There's about five of them, three so far have emerged.
Yeah, and I saw you've got World Inferno Friendship Society. Actually, I did a video for them about 12 years ago. Brian Viglione, he's a local guy here.
Sorry I can't be as suave as Jack for you all of a sudden here. Even own one of those neo vintage mic looking things either.
Yeah. They are suave. All right, but so obviously you've been doing all the what would Jello do things, which are goes back 9 years or so.
And I don't even know. It could be at this point. I mean, the first one I did was when that right-wing eBay creature, who's now a never-Trumper, Meg Whitman, was running for governor against Jerry Brown with all these kind of wild smears, and then trying to buy the governorship. You know, hey, everything should be for sale on eBay, right? I'll just buy that. And I noticed in her ads, she hardly ever appeared in her ads. When you see her, you know why. And I thought, oh my God, where have I seen this face before? Charles Laughton, the Hunchback of Notre Dame. That creepy Southern senator in this great anti-McCarthyism movie with Henry Fonda called The Best Man. He plays this creepy Southern senator, master actor. And he played Captain Bly, too, in one of the Bounty movies. But then Ralph, our guitar player, we were working on mixing Enhanced Methods of Questioning, the EP that came out after the first album. And then Ralph pulled up Meg Whitman and Laughton side by side on his computer. I was like, oh my God, they were separated at birth. So that was the first one. And then it kind of grew and grew from there because I don't really do the spoken word shows anymore. Once I made my long overdue return to rock with Guantanamo School of Medicine, I couldn't really juggle the band and those responsibilities and everything and spoken word shows at the same time. And then plus I had this kick-ass one exposing all the really real reasons we were in Iraq and what was going on with that and everything. And then Obama announced in 2007 and nobody was interested anymore. We were going to be saved. Oh, that was going to make everything all better. You know, even won an advertising award beating out McDonald's for the hopey changey stuff and everything. You know, and people even then, of course, were railing that he was a socialist. And I was thinking, yeah, if only. That's what we need right now. You know, and I finally switched over from calling myself an anarchist to a socialist many decades ago now, because anarchy for personal lifestyle. But Timmy O'Hanlon of Maximum Rock and Roll, who was a longtime socialist, said, you know, the reason I believe in socialism is you have to have a government to transfer the wealth from people who have too much to people who don't have enough. And I think he's right. And you need a government for that. Not the kind we have now where they're transferring it the other way. And I saw, I think, Vanity Fair, of all people, and the only ones who've reported this so far, is that whoever, I think his name is Wolf, the temporary head of Homeland Security, because Trump doesn't want to try and get anybody confirmed, even by McConnell's Senate, so he can put more unqualified wingnuts in high positions who answer only to him. And this guy Wolf told Tucker Carlson on Fox News, came right out and said he and William Barr were going over and having meetings and looking at all the laws to see how they could do a mass roundup of people connected, not just what they call Antifa, but with Black Lives Matter, arrested for being linked to terrorist group Black Lives Matter. Mass roundups were both on the list, buddy. A lot of people watching this, this is you know, we all thought it can't happen here. They won't let it go that far. Even the military were saying you don't pull that stuff, sending soldiers in just so you can wave a Bible upside down in front of a church in D.C. during George Floyd protests. So lo and behold, Trump had his separate military force, paramilitary force, already down at the southern border that was Homeland Security guys, not answerable to anybody in the Pentagon, and only answerable to the head of Homeland Security, who of course is somebody barely qualified for the job, who will do whatever Trump tells them to. And these are kind of these troops like they had in Portland for a test run. They're the sickest of us
there.
Basically, they're the ones who tear little kids away from the arms of their parents because their skin is the wrong color and send them who knows where, you know, possibly to gourmet pate factories for all I know. You know, they didn't keep track of who the kids were, what their names were, who their parents were in a lot of cases. And most of those kids, they're out of the news now. You know, corporate McNews only likes everywhere from 1 to 3 stories at a time to just go on and on over and over and over and over and over again, rather than hire more reporters and crews to cover more stories. You know, that's a major part of it too, along with keeping people less informed, is it's just more cost effective to the corporations who swallowed the one-time independent news networks. You know, even Rachel Maddow answers to Comcast. Don't forget that. And that's why those little kids are not in the news anymore and maybe dying in mass of COVID right now.
Fucking A, man. Yeah.
Look at the wicked witch nose in this camera angle. Look at that. I got the biggest nose I've ever had in my life.
Yes, I was out in Portland for a week when the feds came out there, and that is some of the craziest shit that I've been to. The only thing that was crazier was that I was out in Minneapolis for about a week and a half, right in the wake of the George Floyd murder. I got right out there, and they were burning everything in sight. I was in the middle of a drive-by shooting. I saw National Guardsmen reenacting it almost, tearing a black man off the hood of his car, beating him down, stealing his car, driving off. The dude jumps on the back of that and goes down the road on the fucking Humvee. And
had a camera. Why wasn't it posted?
Oh, it's posted. Jimmy Dore shared it out. But I mean, it was just
send
mass.
It to alternative tentacles. I haven't seen it. That's a interesting one.
I will send you the link, but mass insanity.
You were trying to get me on that Jimmy Dore show, but I don't think we've heard back.
Just message him on Twitter.
I avoid Twitter. I am not on Facebook. I am not on Instagram, and happier for it. I never had a MySpace page either. Yes, there's a Facebook thing with my name on it, Alternative Tentacles Runs, along with a few fake ones still out there. The irony was, when there was MySpace, there was about a dozen fake Jello Biafras and 2 dozen fake Wesley Willises.
Oh, that should be an honor. I mean,
and he died in 2003.
Wesley was great. I saw you talking about him on one of the, was it the episode where you had the mask on? Well, that's another point. Since we're talking about Antifa, you did an episode where you were talking about, and this was pre George Floyd, where you were saying that, I think you were talking about the 99 Seattle protests and saying that no matter what you're doing, even if you're fighting Nazis, that the mass media, the corporate media, is going to portray you as violent anarchists. And I'm interested that you...
And look how the Trump people are working with that now. I mean, yeah. Kellyanne Conway is the only one who said it in public, is the more violent this country gets, the better it is for Dirty Donnie Trump amok, and the easier it will be for him to steal another election. Because by then, you know, if there's enough needs, he has to send in his own private Gestapo all over the place, then they can all just show up, plus put out calls on Twitter and Facebook or whatever from Patriot Prayer and all the other wannabe Patriot Prayers for people to all get in your pickup trucks, get those American flags and Trump 2020, maybe even a Stars and Bars. It's about time, isn't it? And don't go all 600 of you to downtown Portland. Each one of you split up and go to all 600 polling places on November 3rd, draw your guns, have them sitting there, and just look at everybody who's in line to try and vote. and look at all the people, especially people of color, who then turn right around and go home because they're scared you're going to kill them. You know, that's what the machine guns in the Michigan Capitol building were a dry run for, too. They were from out of state, financed in part by Betsy DeVos's family, which, of course, also includes her brother, Eric Prince, of Blackwater fame. And, you know, and they're on deck, too, after all. And so, you know, and plus he could just deputize them. I mean, Trump has talked about deputizing all these sheriff's officers to do his bidding, or even some of the militia groups have, you know, the ones who say the county sheriff is the ultimate authority in the whole country. You know, hey, let's deputize them and then they'll do what we want them to do. So, and he never thought it would get past the fringe, but, you know, it's almost to the point where when the Southern Poverty Law Center compiles their neo-Nazi and hate group lists and the violent militias, they should just put Congress on the list. And maybe the White House and the alleged Justice Department and the Department of Homeland Insecurity, and just put them on there. I mean, I have long felt that with all the money they have, they should be spending more time suing the police. Because that's where the lynchings are going on.
I'm suing the Manchester police, in New Hampshire. But that we don't want to talk about me. But that reminds me. That's the whole thing with this the stimulus package. It's you know, they're just pouring trillions of dollars out there, the greatest transfer of wealth in human history, and they act like it's nothing. And the Democrats and the Republicans are participating with it together. Bernie Sanders, AOC, all the progressive heroes have just gone and done it. How fucked up
I don't
is that?
Know whether I would make it that blanket, but I think if for some reason we overcome all the gerrymandering and the interstate cross-checking and the militia nuts with gigantic tricked-out guns showing up at polling places to check for so-called vote fraud so they can, you know, have the real vote fraud and everything, if somehow, you know, that coelacanth Biden gets in anyway, blowtorch up the ass the whole time, him and Harris both. I mean, I would have preferred her for attorney general if she was going to go anywhere, but not this. But, you know, it's kind of ISIS her for that. And you can't put Elizabeth Warren there, or the Republican governor of Massachusetts appoints another McConnell ally or something. But anyway, the point being, once they're in, blowtorch up their ass. Don't go home. As you know, people got so burned out after fighting Vietnam and Jim Crow in the 60s and then Watergate to get Nixon ridden out of town on a rail. You know, just the whole shock at that point that the president would be a crook and stuff. This was new then. And instead of an entire army of Richard Nixon's running things practically ever since. But the point being, people got burned out. They wanted it back to their lives. They were older. You know, we got to find a job, maybe even start a family, even listen to awful music that's a little quieter than before and stuff. But, you know, that generation kind of burned out. And you can hardly can't blame them in a way, but we can't do is burn out after this so-called election, because a President Biden is going to do everything he thinks he can get away with, even if there's a Democratic Senate, to maintain business as usual. He is a business as usual faction of the Democrats, you know, who may basically owns the party for all practical purposes. And he was already floating, bringing in Larry Summers to quote unquote fix the economy, the same guy who did more than anybody else to prevent it from being fixed the last time, the same guy who then, you know, was done with that. He's president of what, Harvard University, and he had to resign after saying that women weren't as good as math and science as men were, and we have to account for that. But the worst part, what really tells you what an asshole this guy is back when he was either head or something, I think it was World Bank, not IMF, he said, quote, Africa is vastly underpolluted. And we have to measure people by the value of their, so quote, future earning stream. In other words, if you don't look like you're going to be buying a lot of junk and you're not going to have a lot of money and you live there, we should pollute you. Send all the trash and toxic waste to you. Why? Because you're poor, you're Africa, and we, Whitey at World Bank, think you deserve it. You know? So I never forgot that. I thought this guy is incredibly evil. I assumed he was a Bush Republican and slated for their next reign of terror, but then Bill Clinton made him Secretary of the Treasury. So he's the Democrats slash and burn guy for that.
So what do you make of Joe Biden?
Biden wanted to put him in charge of the economy. This is where you have to have a blowtorch up that guy's ass. He was all for, I've always supported the Hyde Amendment, so all these people can't terminate pregnancies, and I'm a good Catholic. Oops, that may make me lose to Bernie. Okay, all of a sudden I'm not. But once I get in, I'll be for it all over again. What do you want to bet?
Well, but that's the thing. I mean, to a certain degree, Obama canceled the primaries, which seemed fucking utterly insane to me. And it seems like most of the people paid no notice to it. It wasn't like there was an X that he wrote on a piece of paper, but he had a sit down meeting with Biden. With Bernie and Buttigieg and Klobuchar and all the others, and basically said, no, sorry, primary is over. We're doing this Biden thing. And Biden's the architect of, he wrote the Patriot Act. He's the architect of the.
Well, no, he actually didn't. He wrote another bill and then threw a childish hissy fit when the Patriot Act went in. John Ashcrack stole the bill from him. You know, he is one of the godfathers of the war on drugs, the godfathers of the mandatory long sentences type bill. Yeah, that's him in a nutshell. He's not our friend. I'm not sure he'd send his own private stormtroopers into Portland. I mean, that's the kind of choice they're going to give us.
I'll give you that.
Is no more stormtroopers, but everything else, you know, you're not going to get the tax cuts repealed and stuff like that. I mean, we learned that the last time when Obama gets in, Holder's the attorney general. He doesn't do a damn thing about the Wall Street crooks, doesn't prosecute a single one. And then all the hype comes in and 20, oh, looks like the Democrats are going to lose all their House seats. Oh, looks like all this stuff's going to go on. Oh, it's inevitable. It was not inevitable. It was just monstrous malpractice from the Barack star to Harry Reid and especially Nancy Pelosi, who I am cursed with having quote unquote represented all these years, you know, the same machine that Willie Brown is now the patriarch of, Brown Burton machine that gave us Feinstein and gave us Gavin Newsom and gave us Kamala Harris, who was a Willie Brown ex-girlfriend. That's how she got started. I mean, she has proven competent and did better as state attorney general in the Senate than I thought she would, but we'll see how much farther that's going to go, because she is from that machine. And of course, they handpick all the mayors of San Francisco in part to make sure that nobody ever enforces the Raker Act and makes PG&E give us our power that was supposed to be public after they built the Hetch Hetchy Dam. No mayor or no city attorney, DA, ever goes after PG&E for breaking the law on that. That was the compromise to let them put the Hetch Hetchy Dam up in Yosemite National Park, is that the power to San Francisco will be publicly owned. And this is great San Francisco corruption for you. They ran out of copper and stuff for the pipes over in Hayward in the East Bay. Along comes Pacific Gas and Electric saying, oh, hey, we've got this extra pipe right here. We'll finish it for you. We'll even do it for free, but you got to give us a monopoly on power in San Francisco. And we take all the money, charge as much as we want, and, act accordingly.
It reminds me of
paying for all their nuke plant failures, too, as well as all the fires they've caused.
So you notice actually the Democrats are on board with nuclear power now. What do you think of that?
They always were.
Oh, now they're open about it, I guess.
We can't possibly get rid of coal unless we substitute something even more toxic than coal so our buddies can make money. I mean, Why are we even talking about this? That's always the way they've been. Obama was pro-nuke too, remember?
Right. No, I'm just saying that. So, I
mean, also talked about clean coal.
That's true.
Which, but as far as I know, is still a scientific myth.
Sure, but they carted out John Kasich, who's, you know, one of these guys who's so anti-women's rights that he came up with some kind of...
I know.
I mean, I
nicknamed him Governor Sick years ago.
It's like there's no Democratic Party anymore. They're just straight up inviting Republicans to their events. I'm surprised Jeb Bush wasn't there.
Give him a little time. I mean, part of it is because there's a lot of them are tossing and turning, wondering whether they still want to be associated with Dirty Donnie Trump amok or any of these nut jobs who are following him into Congress and everything else, or they're starting to get a little scared that there may be a bunch of QAnon people, including a senator or two, if they don't do something. And so Biden is somebody they always could, as they say, do business with. I'd love to know his voting record on what Supreme Court justices he voted for.
Right.
He voted against Clarence Thomas, but made doubly sure he got on the bench by cutting off all other witnesses besides Anita Hill, the fact that Thomas was a rapist. So, Biden is a frightening dude, but you know, he is 78 years old, and you can even tell when he's trying to be passionate, which he occasionally was in the debates, or when he was, you know, really ripping into Bernie Sanders in the interview, suddenly there was some fire there. You know, he was articulate and everything, but not so much now. So I don't know how much gas he has left in the tank. He may have a lot. I don't know. You know, look at how long Fidel Castro lasted. He could give a speech for 6 hours at a time and not take a drink of water in that climate. So, there may be a lot left there, including a lot left with Trump amok, too. You never know. Some people are too mean to die. Imagine how I felt when Frank Zappa died of prostate cancer, but Jesse Helms survived his.
That was, 92 he died, right?
I don't remember. But I think it was later than that.
I feel like it was
a bit later, actually, because Gail Zappa spent time in the Lincoln bedroom and was palling with the Clinton Democrats and making nice with the Gores and whatnot because she wanted a seat at the table for both of them on policy.
Okay, I'll take your word on the year. I feel like it was between 92.
And that would have been sometime between 92 and 96 in the second Clinton. No, 96 and 2000 during the second Clinton term.
Okay, well, Ed, but so speaking of QAnon, which is the crazy.
Do we have to?
No, it just reminded me of something else. We don't have to talk about QAnon. But it actually reminded me, so they did this big takedown 2 weeks ago. 2018, they did the Facebook takedown of 800 lefty pages. And then
I did not know about that either.
Yeah. So 2 weeks ago, they took down.
Send me some info.
I absolutely will. They took down a bunch of QAnon stuff, the militias, and any anarchist pages like It's Going Down, Crime Think, MC Soul.
Oh, really?
Oh, wow. Fuck, yeah. So I'm surprised you don't know this, because it leads to the reason that I'm asking you about it, and what's interesting about it is your connection is the whole thing with the PMRC and the fact that we're in this new age of I guess it's not technically censorship, but I feel like they're getting so many subsidies from the government, it might as well be fucking censorship.
Who is?
Facebook, Google gets $600 million in per year in government subsidies, and a variety of government think tanks. They're absolutely working in tandem with the U.S. government. But I guess you don't know about it, so I'll just send you some links. But I figured that
nobody can keep up with everything. And it does get harder and harder, even for me with my sick sense of humor, to say stave off badass depression and just throw up my hands at all this shit. At least I have an outlet, and I'm very grateful that you and many more, check out my music or interested in my new stuff, and, you know, that I didn't wind up somebody nobody listens to or gives a shit about who's the drunk at the end of the bar nobody wants to listen to and stuff. you know, I have a platform, and of course it does mean, you know, pressure and responsibility to do good stuff with it, you know, make the music good, make the lyrics good, and do the best I can to go as far as I can without being a dick about it.
Well, I think the stuff you're doing now is great. I mean, it's some of your best stuff. That Taliban USA, the Big Gulp. All I mean, I've been listening to those songs constantly, and I mean, I love all the stuff that you do on What Would Jello Do. I
Yeah,
mean,
I mean, coming
I don't
up
know why you
is
don't
th
you, like.
there's some more. There's another video up called "We Created Putin,"
I don't know if I've seen that one.
that YouTube already slapped an X rating on once, but now we put it back up again. So watch it quick, people. But the whole premise of "We Created Putin" is important here because we did, and how we did it is, and I feared this for a long time. Let's go back to World War One, like the song does. Germany is defeated, and everybody just decides to kick their ass of the whole civilian population. No rebuilding, no aid. The inflation is so bad, it really did take a wheelbarrow full of money to buy a loaf of bread for a while. And people, as you might guess, got angrier and angrier and angrier and more frustrated. Feeling alone, feeling abandoned, and whatever else. Oh, this guy's gonna fix things. Let's vote for him. Let's support him. Yeah, Nazi Party. We like it. National Socialist, Adolf Hitler. He sounds pretty good. Let's go with this guy. And we all know what happened after that. So then, after World War II, at least we learned that we better not just abandon the people we just vanquished. So, Marshall Plan for Germany and rebuilding Japan on our own, you know, help them with that and establish a democratic kind of government, which was better than an emperor who could be pushed around by a nut job like Tojo and stuff. So it was like William Barr on crack. He was more like Oliver North, I suppose, but or actually much worse. But anyway, you get my point. We put in things to make it better for people there. And maybe it was just self-serving so that we wouldn't have World War III 10 years later. But the bottom line is it worked. So why was there no Marshall Plan when the Soviet Union collapsed? Great big void, economic misery, all kinds of things that people did get in the communist dictatorship, like health care and at least some kind of a shitty ass job or whatever. Poof, gone. A little upset, you know. Gorbachev and Yeltsin kind of himself out of there. Well, I think it was when Yeltsin was in, he didn't get the highest block of people in the Duma. The highest block was about 25%, and it was a complete lunatic that puts Trump and Putin to shame by the name of Vladimir Zhirinovsky. I think he's even still in the Duma to this day. He went from running a heavy metal boutique and stuff to almost taking over Russia. And he was all about, when I take over, there will be dictatorship. Did a press conference in front of his map of Greater Russia that even included Finland, let alone Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania, and all of those. I mean, he was like an uber nationalist. And the whole thing went to his head. He got in fist fights on the floor of the Duma. Maybe he still does. And slowly but surely, he was such a buffoon, he could only go so far. But I thought, oh my God. I had this song written called Do the Zhirinovsky, that then he was kind of fading, never did the song. And then I thought, if they ever get a smart Zhirinovsky, the whole world is in real trouble. Enter Vladimir Putin. And of course, we know now he even, you know, stole our, we know now he even kind of helped Trump steal our election. He basically owns the guy, probably not because of the P tape, but my guess on why Putin owns Trump is because around 2000, American banks quit lending to Trump. They wouldn't, he kept declaring bankruptcy and stealing their money one time after another. And so then he goes to Deutsche Bank, borrows $300 million, which he still hasn't paid back, by the way. They're waiting for their pardon from him over the $600 million they stole in 2008. Anyway, so, and that's why they're trying to get the Deutsche Bank records, and Trump won't let them have them. So Deutsche Bank learns, we're not lending to you again, dude. You can't even do gangsterism right. And so then you don't hear about it much, but then right about after the crash of 2008, 2009, who suddenly has money to open up more golf courses, more country clubs, but the Trump Organization? And either Don Jr. or Eric Trump or both, in different interviews in golfing magazines to promote their new resorts, well, how are you getting all this money? You hear something you don't know, see? How are you getting all this money to pay for this when no one will loan anybody any money? And, oh, we don't use American banks. We use Russian banks. Yep. I'm not sure Donald realized, when you borrow from a Russian bank, let alone several of them, you're borrowing from the Russian mob. You don't get to be a bank there unless you're the mob. And who is the head of the Russian mob? Well, we all know who the head of the Russian mob is. You know, it's even more blatant than, you know, than people from crime families like Bush and Trump actually occupying the White House. This is more direct. And so now Trump has crossed the mob, the Russian mob, and he knows damn well that they could call in their chits anytime, suddenly rename a building in New York Putin Tower, change the locks on Mar-a-Lago so he can only peer in the window as Trump's best hookers in the world run wild without him. And of course, the bottom line is, you know, when he's gorging his cheeseburgers late at night and throwing wrappers all over the floor as he tweets, you know, all the things he's going to do to Antifa and everything, and that Biden is anti-God. He really makes Biden look good, I'll give him that. But he knows damn well, you know, there's been reports, like in Lewis Wolf's book, that Trump is hyper paranoid of having his food poisoned. You know how Putin gets rid of people, right?
Oh yeah,
he poisons them. So that's why Trump stops at McDonald's and went, oh, give me that, give me that, give me that. They won't know it's me. They can't poison my food, except with their awful ingredients to begin with. And so Trump is terrified. Hey, not only could I poison you, I could poison Ivanka too. That's the world and the fear he lives in.
So speaking of Mar-a-Lago, I did the drive from Mar-a-Lago to Jeffrey Epstein's house. Do you have any feelings? Because that's the big thing. You hear all the right wingers saying, "Oh, it's the Clintons. You know that's who you know killed him, and you know, or he didn't kill himself, or whatever it is."
Yeah.
Any thoughts on that?
Because it just goes to show how dumb QAnon is that they think Hillary had the child porn ring. You know, there's a bunch of pictures of Epstein and Nymphets and Trump all in the same picture.
Yeah.
Prince Andrew too. And some of those women were underage. You know, I think you're right about corporate McNews really kind of dumbing down and censoring to make sure we don't really rise up against business as usual. Because even fundamentalist Christians sticking to Trump for dear life, because at least he'll put another evangelical extremist on the Supreme Court if Ruth Bader Ginsburg dies, we have to save him because of he's doing this for us. I don't know whether they can handle that.
Right. So all of this actually, it connects to one of the other episodes you did about creative crimes. If you remember that one, you're talking about filming Romney or the prank call on Scott Walker pretending to be the Koch brothers.
And let's hear it for the TikTok kids who fooled Brad Parscale and Trump into thinking a million people were coming to Tulsa. Yep. And he barely broke, what, 6,000 or 7,000? Imagine the tantrums going on when Trump is supposed to be on the outside stage for all those loyal people who couldn't get in, who had to be able to see their precious Trump amok and he could feed off their energy, and they have to cancel it because nobody showed up. Nobody.
So I don't.
And yet there's a huge spike in coronavirus around Tulsa and Oklahoma anyway after that.
Yeah, do you remember about a year ago, there was a bunch of headlines in all the newspapers about a banana that was duct taped to a wall at Art Basel? Do you remember that story?
No.
No, okay, never mind then. It was
a wall of where?
Art Basel, it's the biggest gathering of art galleries in the world. It's down in Miami.
Okay,
this happened about a year ago. It's a ridiculous story because it kind of looks like the Andy Warhol banana.
Right. Somebody taped a banana
to
a wall and then sold it for some huge amount of money.
$120,000. And then someone ate the banana, which made headlines.
I remember this now.
My art crime, because it was a meme going around at the time. Everyone was saying Epstein didn't kill himself. I happened to have my own art show down in Miami at that time, and I saw what they were doing, and I said, fuck it, I've got some lipstick here, and they had the blank wall, and I wrote Epstein didn't kill himself, and so that was my art crime of the week, and I don't know if it was me.
Well, I mean, not all art crimes have us laughing. I mean, Jeffrey Koons is Exhibit A.
So let's talk about George Floyd and you did a bunch of episodes about when the government riots.
Yeah.
And, so if you could talk about that, because that's obviously what is going on now.
People are now trying to backtrack on defunding the police and abolishing the police, although they did do that in Camden, New Jersey, across the river from Philadelphia, with apparently pretty good results so far, although the debate is already on that one. And so yanking a huge amount of money away from the police to pay for more mental health workers, homes for people, education, social services, that is all for the good. I mean, we don't just have a military-industrial complex where we waste a ton of money on a ton of weapons and, you know, a mentality to go with them that we're never actually going to use unless, well, Trump gets another term. But... because I think he may be an end times guy too. I really do. There's religion hiding in there, even though he mainly worships himself. But we don't just have a military industrial complex. We don't just have an election industrial complex now, or a prison industrial complex. We have a police industrial complex. And the police state industrial complex, of course, links in with the prison industrial complex and to some degree the military industrial complex, because once they make certain kinds of military gear that the military is never going to use, then they can quote unquote donate it back to police departments. Thus, these gigantic military occupying Baghdad vehicles rolling into Ferguson, Missouri to try and intimidate everybody. And all these weapons given to SWAT teams, and every little town has to have a SWAT team now. And so now these little towns, SWAT teams, somebody might can crack, call out the get out machine guns. Let's get a battering ram, no knocking, just bulldoze the house down and drag out the bodies. And then we can confiscate the land because obviously drugs were sold there. And under those laws, property seizure laws, we can just sell it and put all the money in the police benefit fund, which is just basically to benefit the police.
For sure. This is a
really tough one, because reforming a police department, you're going up against people who may be second, third, and even fourth generation cops who have their own code, kind of like the mafia or biker gangs, that you never snitch on a fellow cop. You never do this, you never do that, and we protect our own. We are our own independent, well, government, essentially. You know, living outside of town, we come in here to keep these animals down, then we go home and do what we do when we're not doing that, I guess. I don't know. But so it's they know, okay, this DA, this legislature, this mayor, they're only going to be here for 4 or at most 8 years. We can just dig in our heels, go as slow as we can, just fold our arms and refuse. And then sooner or later, you get an official in charge who's more to our liking, and we just go back to going crazy.
So actually, what you're talking about is one of the big arguments that you hear from the conservative is against the anarchist, the whole thing. Well, if you get rid of the police, then there's going to be a vacuum. And, you know, to that degree, I would agree with them, unless you get into Herbert Reed's essay about the paradox of anarchism, that you use tactics, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, so what's your position, or how do you feel on the whole backpedaling from abolish the police to defund the police? I mean, what do you think is going to fill that power vacuum, since there's
I think defund is something to hang on to, as long as you can then say the money should go here as well. That's working. There's a lot of people who get that, who normally wouldn't get, oh, you can't just abolish the police. You can't just defund the police. They might have to walk a beat again and be nice to everybody. You can't. Oh, well, maybe you can. Yeah. So I've just kind of been snickering at watching all the corporate news punditoids and even the main talking heads suddenly being completely down on the cops and not taking their side of the story automatically. I don't know how much longer that's going to last, but never saw that before. So at the very least, Black Lives Matter has accomplished that. And that's important. I mean, people say Occupy was just some big failure. Oh, no, it wasn't. It got inequality onto the front page, onto corporate McNews TV. They didn't want to talk about that. You know, it was going to be a contest between Obama and Romney. You know, who loves Israel more? Who's stronger on defense? Who's stronger on crime? Who's going to help the middle class and cut taxes and stuff? And that's what they were preparing for. They weren't going to talk about inequality until Occupy made it too damn obvious. And luckily, that patriotic prankster who recorded Romney on their phone talking about the 47% who they think they're entitled to health care. They think they're entitled to food, said Mittens. He said that. And so suddenly, that Occupy, along with that, along with Occupy and others making use of that, Mitt Romney scared the living shit out of people, the way Trump should have. I mean, 2012 was not a pro-Obama vote. It was an anti-Romney vote.
Yeah.
But Occupy didn't fail. It was just like Fat Mike walking away from Punk Voter after the 2004 election because it didn't get rid of W. But, you know, as much as disappointed as we were in Barack Star Obama later on, it was sure as hell better than McCain or what they had in mind. You know, we might have President Palin now, or at least after McCain croaked and whatnot. And so a lot of the ground level door, knocking on doors, this, that, and the other, and knowing how to use the net and everything that got Obama in 08 was people from Punk Voter. So it didn't fail at all. It planted the seeds for something more. And I got in with Punk Voter, even though Fat Mike, no effects, who started, he was all in with Democrats. He wanted Howard Dean. Okay, I'll settle for Kerry just to get W out. Okay, I get that. But I also felt that I could do this on my own and nobody would listen to me, but more people would listen if I hooked up with him. And brought a Green Party perspective to Punk Voter and pushed things a little more radical. I mean, we're all in on abolishing the war on drugs. And there was a political director he'd hired who'd run congressional campaigns and other things before, named Scott Goodstein. And he was like, no, that doesn't sell. You can't do that. People won't listen to you if you say that. But even Mike was like, no, we are sticking to this as one of our main points and purpose, because we're right and it's true and it's important. And by the end of it, Scott Goodstein was all in on that and flirted with joining the Green Party, but felt it was too disorganized for his taste, because he'd worked with unions, he'd worked with, you know, real campaigns, blah, blah, blah. And yes, he worked on the Obama campaign. One of the higher ups, who was the one who found the Shepherd Fairey Hope poster and brought it to the rest of the campaign, and the rest is history. However, Scott, who's still a good friend of mine, he decided not to follow a lot of the others into White House jobs and went back into the trenches.
So I don't want to keep you all
night. He has a new thing going. I gotta find this. If I can find it on my smell phone somewhere. Can I find it on my smell phone? Probably need to put the old man glasses on. Maybe, maybe not. I don't find. Yes. It's called, I believe, yeah, I gotta get the glasses on for this. Rememberwhatthedid.com. There it is. Rememberwhatthedid.com. And but there's little sections of remember they did this, remember I did that, and all kinds of little pieces of art and other things. And so that's the one he's working on now. They send out bulletins.
So I don't want to keep you all night, but I wanted to quickly hit. I've got 4 points that I'd love to get to, before we go. Interstate cross check, hackable Diebold voting machines, ranked choice voting, and just the viability of third parties as opposed to duopoly.
Well, the Interstate Cross Check program is what got Trump in 2016. It wasn't Putin. It wasn't even the gerrymandering. It was the additional part of the gerrymandering called the Interstate Cross-Check Program, created by Kris Kobach, that right-wing Wunderkind from Kansas and stuff, who will haunt us the rest of our natural lives. He's like a smarter, more vicious Karl Rove, is what that guy is. I think he's running for Senate this time too, unless he lost his primary, because he's such a prick that Kansas wouldn't make him governor in that state. But anyway, so he came up with this thing, Interstate Cross-Check Program. 29 states opted in. They all gave Kobach their entire voter database for the whole state, puts it all together, and then runs it through his program to flag matching names because it's obviously people voting twice. Therefore, this is going to find all this vote fraud, and we're going to not let them vote. And he had it skewed to flag people like Washington, named Washington, because so many Washingtons are African American, Wong, Chin, and boy, if your name is Jose Gonzalez or Juan Guerrero or Julio Martinez, all 5,000 of you didn't get to vote in those states, and most of you voted absentee, don't even know it. Where were all the black people for Hillary? And they didn't vote in North Carolina. Actually, they probably did, because Greg Palast, first he wrote articles about this, and then he had a documentary movie with the same title as his book on how Bush stole 2000, called The Best Democracy Money Can Buy. Still worth watching. Even Ice-T and Richard Belzer are in it doing their Law and Order characters on a real crime. Vote fraud from the real vote fraud. You know, it's the same stealing the term before we could control it, like calling Earth First eco-terrorists instead of oil companies, or they're pro-life even though they hate kids once they're born and all that. They don't like anybody. And then and then vote fraud. Somehow, vote fraud is looking for evil, wicked people with Spanish last names instead of knowing all the fraud that put Dirty Don in office. And more importantly, United States, more importantly, in my opinion, there are a bunch of Tea Party crackpots, including people like Toomey in Pennsylvania for Senator Toomey, Senator Ron Johnson, who just was there for all to see how horrific that guy is. He was supposed to lose to Russell Feingold. Feingold get a seat back, but didn't. Richard Burr in North Carolina and some other ones, they were all supposed to lose, but they didn't. And they got in instead just in time to put Gorsuch and Kavanaugh on the Supreme Court. That's the damage that Kobach and Crosscheck did, and they're just getting started. Now, an ACLU suit got Crosscheck thrown out, at least for the state of Kansas, and Palast wrote me back a few days ago saying, no, Crosscheck is actually gone now. It fell apart. But they have all these other cross checks and all these new ways of, just a guy like Brian Kemp, who was the Secretary of State of Georgia, who was able to make himself governor by just bragging he had 50,000 applicants to vote sitting on his desk, and most of them were African American, and he was just wasn't going to look at it before the election.
Right.
It's that blatant. It's that in your face and all. And, and now we're even going to like see if we can wreck the post office just so people can't vote. I mean, but then somehow corporate McSnooze isn't saying that the reason the post office is in dire straits financially is there was a law passed during the W years where the post office, unlike any other business in the history of the world, had to pre-fund all its pensions 75 years in advance and pay for it all now. And all that money that's supposed to pay for it has actually then been scooped and put back at the U.S. government's general fund, and the pension isn't there at all. It's getting looted to that scale. Obama and our buddy Biden had 8 years to get rid of that regulation, and they didn't. You know, but that's huge. That's something you could blowtorch Biden and Harris with this time around. For crying out loud, get a list of all these little executive orders Trump did, getting all these environmental laws and everything else. Okay, Uncle Joe, you get in, come out of your little coelacanth aquarium, and, you know, sign all these executive orders overturning these, have them all ready to go, and just wave the phone book size stack of them in the air on inauguration day and do it day one, not day 301, day one. Two can play at this executive order game, for crying out loud. So, there's that, and as far as the other things voting goes, I mean, Palast encourages everybody to re-register and make sure they're on the rolls again. And he said in North Carolina alone last time, I think Hillary lost by a little over 10,000 votes, and something like 75,000 people were kicked off because of cross-check. Mm-hmm. And in Wisconsin, we're approaching seven figures of the number of voters kicked off the rolls since Scott Walker first became governor. And his legislature still runs the show because, and that's another part of showing up and voting, you got to vote smart. And that doesn't just mean voting for a president you think will be all better, make it all better just because you can easier stomach seeing his face on TV for the next 4 to 8 years. And that's how we pick our presidents. But Wisconsin, in 2018, they got a Democratic governor, and all the state offices went to Democrats, but both houses of the state legislature is still in control of Tea Party Republicans that got there during the Scott Walker seizure of power. They're still that regime, so they're blocking the governor at every turn, passing laws, regulations, saying that the legislature now has this power instead of the governor. They passed that lame duck so that Walker could sign it. The point being, you're going to vote, you read your whole ballot, you find out who's running for state representative, state senate, mayor, county commissioner, house of representatives, and, you know, all the ballot initiatives too. When people like us don't show up, you get anti-immigrant stuff, you don't get rent control, you get sports stadiums instead of low-income housing, you name it. You got to watch this stuff because that the local offices are where the action really is, and nobody knows that better than the religious right when it comes to school boards.
So if I could jump in about the rent control thing, that actually wasn't on my list, but you've got a song called Lynch the Landlords. Well, what do you think about the impending crisis? You know, if these moratoriums on you know, rent go away, you know, what's going to happen with the massive?
Well, if Dirty Donnie and all his minions and other forms of governments and state governments, if he wants to save his ass, they better keep the moratorium on rent and evictions, because otherwise there's going to be so many tent camps all over the place. The only place to put them is going to be in the middle of major intersections, be ready to pack up and run, and then more tents appear as soon as the cops leave, over and over and over again. I mean, there were so many Hoovervilles being erected by homeless people and jobless people at the worst part of the Depression, when Herbert Hoover just thought that the market was going to correct everything and you just got to leave it alone, everything will be fine. That it got so wild in Washington, D.C., Hoover had federal government troops fire on people and killed some of them.
Yeah.
And that sank his presidency and got FDR in. A lot of other things did too, like one Hooverville, two Hooverville, three Hooverville, etc. And he also was anti-prohibition.
Well, that'll do it. So maybe the last thing, we could hit is ranked choice voting. Can you talk about that?
In San Francisco, we have ranked choice voting.
Oh, yeah?
And sometimes there's only one or two candidates I know enough about to vote for them, and I leave it at that. And I think that happens with a lot of people. But ranked choice means when you have a number one choice, a number two choice, and things like that. Democratic primary, you could do things like, okay, Bernie number one, Elizabeth Warren number two. You'll notice how corporate McMedia and whatnot sank Warren starting last September because they got too scared of her. You know, she's more electable than Bernie. She could actually win. She'd probably be a more effective president. We got to push all the riffraff into the Bernie camp so we can get, well, we hope it isn't Biden. We hope there's some young so-called moderate somebody will actually go for. And they didn't go for any of them. So at the end of the day, okay, I guess we got to go with fucking Biden and stuff. But yeah, and I'm forgetting the question. Oh, ranked choice voting. What people could have done that would have really helped both Bernie and Elizabeth Warren is that, you know, say you could vote for two or vote for three or vote for four, Bernie number one, Lizzie number two. I don't know. I mean, even though he was disappointing when his politics came out, you could put Beto O'Rourke four or Buttigieg three or whatever. There were probably some others that were better than them that I'm spacing on right now. I mean, there were a bunch I just didn't look into that carefully because the clown car was getting so damn full. I mean, even a bench-warming senator who somehow thought there, from my old home state, thought somehow there was some national groundswell for President Michael Bennett. It didn't work out that way. Yeah. I mean, and maybe what we need to do with these people, even better than ranked choice voting, is to have everybody follow the example of Pope John Paul I. Remember him? The dude with the glasses who was only Pope for a month died. And I thought, yeah, this is what to do with all these people who think they should be president. I mean, people who think they should be president of this country almost automatically are probably too mentally ill to actually be president.
Yes.
If they're that, you know, if they're, what's the word for Trump? Not if their narcissism is already that bad.
Right.
But maybe the thing to do with all these narcissistic people who think they should be president from, you know, and all these people are going to run again, and Gavin Newsom wants to be president in the worst kind of way. He was even talking about when he became president, when Willie Brown first appointed him to the Board of Supervisors when he was a young wonder boy raised by the Getty family in their mansion. And he already thought he was going to be president. And yeah. So all those people, fine. Each of you gets to be president for 30 days, and then you die.
There you go. Well, all right.
They couldn't do any more damage than Trump that way. They'd still be learning the job, and then...
I think that's the perfect note to end on, unless there's anything else you want to say. I don't know.
Well, I think get to emphasizing since the 2020 ballot stuff is where the action is, and you have to be smart about that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you're a fucking legend. You know, thank you for doing this. I don't know. I don't know what else is there to say.
All right.
Well, I mean, I want to hear more of the new band.
What's that?
I want to hear more of the new band. I mean, I think that's I want to see more of your podcast.
Well, I mean, we have stuff out already. You could be getting into
the
Audacity of Hype was the first album.
Yeah.
This is Guantanamo School of Medicine. I haven't been in Dead Kennedy since 1986, even though the rogue people have more in common with Trump than Dead Kennedy's ran off of the name. Still
right.
Seem to put my picture in an awful lot of ads for the gigs, but buyer beware. You want it to continue, you want that spirit, and you know the old family recipe from the brains of the operations wrote most of the music as well as the lyrics. My music is in Guantanamo School of Medicine. That's where you get the continuum, and it keeps going on. And you know, I think we still come up with pretty good stuff. I mean, it's because I always just didn't stick to one kind of punk rock. I mean, I'm so damn old. Yeah, I am part of the old school. And we don't think of it as a school back then. You think of schools, you think of gym teachers and assistant principals and homework and proms you don't want to go to and jocks you don't want to deal with and all the, and mean girls who would become the cheerleading squad and all. Uh-huh. Right. You, no school. No, we were blowing up the school. And one of my proudest achievements is that I helped burn down the Hotel California. And that spirit continues. You know, Guantanamo School of Medicine isn't old man punk light or formula or whatever. I listen to tons of different kinds of music. I blend it all together so you don't even recognize where a lot of it came from. But keep it heavy. Keep it fierce. That's been the idea with Audacity of Hype. And then the second album was White People and the Damage Done. And new one is called Tea Party Revenge Porn.
Yeah.
And I wrote that song and even Satan's Comb Over before Trump even stole the election in 2016. Mm-hmm. You know, the Tea Party was already, all I had to do for Tea Party Revenge Porn was just kind of laundry list their own conspiracy theories. And you have a fall over belly laugh funny song about how stupid and dangerous these people really are. You know, immediately when the Tea Party stuff started, I couldn't stop thinking of that Herschel Gordon Lewis splatter movie, 2000 Maniacs.
Mm-hmm.
Ever seen that? We're just in time for our jamboree. And they roll the guy down the hill in the barrel with nails in it and drop a giant rock on somebody else of these tourists who wandered into town and stuff. And one carload escapes. And then they look back and the town evaporates into thin air along with everybody in it. But just a little plaque saying this was where there was a massacre where Union soldiers killed all the people in this town. So they were all ghosts, basically.
There was it reminds me of that movie, The Cars That Ate Paris. Do you remember that one?
I've seen that.
It's a horror movie about anthropomorphic cars.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, so that's Tea Party Revenge Porn. That wasn't going to go away. And Satan's Comb Over, the phenomenon, didn't start with him. It's the name for it. But National Front in France was much earlier. Brexit already went down. Alternative for Germany and the anti-immigration stuff in Holland organized. It's nearly taken over the country several times. That's earlier. Denmark had somebody like that running the country for a while. And then you get to the really horrible ones that you hope aren't the models for Trump and Barr with their roundup of Black Lives Matter terrorists. You've got Duterte in the Philippines, where the death toll may be approaching 20,000 from his death squads. And a lot of them aren't even his death squads. It's just like, you know, the neo-Nazis now, let alone Antifa, there isn't a central leadership. They just, oh, I always did want to shoot my neighbor. You're a drug dealer.
Well, if I can jump in there, I accidentally interviewed Matthew Heimbach of the Traditionalist Workers Party at the RNC in 2016. He became one of the main figures of Unite the Right at Charlottesville, basically a neo-Nazi. And what I discovered, and it was like a comedic interview where I was on the bullhorn and basically ridiculing him for being a Nazi. But one of the big things that I learned from doing that, he supported Duterte and Hezbollah, and there's this whole movement of neo-Nazis.
Duterte and Hezbollah?
Yes.
That's really weird.
This new movement.
Duterte and Bolsonaro are fundamentalist Catholics, and that's
right,
not
but so
Hezbollah's favorite people.
So the weird thing that unites them, at least in the opinion of Heimbach, was that they're all nationalists or ultra-nationalists, and he would give all these interviews saying that he was in support of them, and it was the weirdest. It was kind of blowing my mind that there was this weird kind of neo-Nazi. But sorry, just an aside.
Well, I mean, there was some rapport between the Aryan Nations and Louis Farrakhan back then,
right?
Because they both wanted separation of the races.
Great. Politics makes strange bedfellows.
So basically, Satan's Comb Over is about all of them.
Yeah.
and I didn't really hit the nail on the head in the song. I might have to do another song on that. Is why is this level of outright fascism and pop stardom for the leaders and all the corporate McNews everywhere, why is it happening all over the world at the same time? It's as though somebody up top, where the money really is, and you know, we are sick of this Occupy stuff. We are sick of these environmentalists. We are sick of these people. Time has come to really clamp down and stomp them. I mean, this is, as I say in the Tea Party Revenge Porn song, they're not trying to go back to the 1950s. They're trying to go back to the 1850s. When there was still slavery, like when Rand Paul said, yeah, abolishing slavery was a property taking and the owners still haven't been compensated.
Oh, Jesus.
You know, that's the way they're countering reparations for right. the slaves' descendants, too.
Right.
Maybe it was Ron Paul who said that, but it might as well be both of them because they're both hyper-racist on top of everything else.
Yeah, all those newsletters full of the martini glasses with Stars of David in them. That was the old Ron Paul newsletter.
I didn't know that one.
Oh, horrifying. Yeah, look up some of those.
Yeah.
Just pretend like it didn't happen.
Another thing, besides all the monkeying with the votes in 2000, however, that cost Gore that election, well, he did. You know, they had their press war ready the next day in case he lost to blame it all on Ralph Nader and us Greens. But damn it, Gore did it himself. Picking Lieberman cost him millions of votes right there. I was covering the Republican convention in Philadelphia for Free Speech TV, and I had a local kid there who was my camera guy, and he lived at home. And he said that his parents were Jewish, were so excited that a Jew was going to be on the ticket. Lieberman was on the ticket. Then they saw an interview with him and told their son they're voting for Nader. You know, that was one of Gore's, you know, I thought, who is the worst person he could possibly pick? Dianne Feinstein. No, there's somebody even worse. Oh my God, he picked him. But anyway, there was that. And then Lieberman then worked for Bush once the votes were tangled in Florida. He said it was disrespecting our military not to count military ballots mailed in, postmarked after Election Day, and all these other ones that obviously been sent out after Election Day and whatnot. He wanted all those counted. I think they ultimately were. And of course, as palace documents, Gore spent so much time bitching and moaning about dimply old ladies' chads, the old ladies' dimply chads in South Florida, he completely ignored what people like Jesse Jackson were trying to alert him to in North Florida, where tens, if not hundreds of thousands of African Americans weren't allowed to vote. And Greg Palast documented how. They just slapped felony convictions on all these voters. And you look carefully, oh, you were convicted of a felony in 2014 and stuff like that. And they got away with it. I mean, one of the lawyers was Ted Cruz and whatnot, and William Barr, I think, was down there, and James Baker was down there and whatnot. So there was that, but there's one other thing that really played a major role in costing Al Gore that election, his wife. Her hate campaign against music cost him young people's votes across the board. But she'd been playing the race card by then and going after NWA and Public Enemy and Ice-T and whatnot. You can scare way more suburban white moms with the N-word and that stuff than you can that there might be they might their children might be listening to music by Negroes than the guy with the horns. So she cost her husband the election, not writer Tipper Gore.
I'd have heard this one in Minneapolis. I heard it playing everywhere. Instead of NWA's Talk to the Police, it was this guy called Boozy Badass. And it's so the main refrain is still Fuck the Police. But check it out. A lot of people say it's problematic. There's some misogyny, et cetera, that kind of thing going on. But a great song.
Isn't an NWA?
Say again?
And there isn't an NWA?
Oh, no, there is an NWA. I'm just saying.
I don't know what Chuck D would say about it now, but the first Public Enemy album has a song on it called Sophisticated Bitch about snobby women. But the solution to the snobbery, you know, guess what? If I recall, it's a little of the old domestic violence.
I'm just saying that's the kids are big into this Boozy Badass guy. That's all.
Well, better than what, I mean, you can't really say what Trump wants people to listen to because you can't really visualize even his monster children actually liking music. Supposedly, Tiffany has been trying for a singing career for years, and her little songs go nowhere.
Is that true?
Oh, as far as QAnon goes, I mean, I suspect that QAnon is in all likelihood Trump himself. Or maybe Trump and Don Jr. and some of the others just having fun from time to time. It just dovetails too neatly in that. You know, I think it's Trump.
I don't know if they're smart enough to come up with it, honestly. But, you know, maybe they've got a publicist that writes it for them. Hard to say. Oh, it's, he had that fake publicist name that he did back in the 80s. I don't know. Maybe he just ran.
Oh, Trump had one. Yeah.
Yeah. Like John Barron, yeah. I think, was.
Yeah. Yeah. He named his last kid after a fake publicist.
Right? That's fucking awesome. What an asshole. Oh, fuck.
No, no, no. Even though there's two R's in your name, it's really short. It was going to be Robert Baron Trump for Robber Baron. But then we just decided on Baron because you're the Baron. All right, time to go.
Yep, yep. No, that's a great note to end on. Thank you so much for doing this. You stayed much longer than I thought you would. So.
All right. Take care.
Fucking great. Thanks, Joe.
All right. All right. Okay.
All right.
the lock the doors, shove in your face, let it feed us photographs. Hey, Donna Reed ain't free. God's handmade plan for you. Hosted, wanted, get her.